After some illness and surrounded by her family. First item of business is approval of the agenda, which I sent out last week.
Could we ask you to speak up so we can hear you?
Thank you, Jerry. I will attempt to project and ask the rest of the board to do the same.
Thank you.
We've just had a request from the public to speak up, and so please do, everybody. The first item on our agenda is approval of the agenda, which
I make a motion to accept the agenda.
Second.
All right. It's moved by Barry Miller and seconded by Dorothea to accept the agenda as it was sent out. Any discussion? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The motion carries. I'd like to say a few words about the agenda. In the middle of the agenda, we're going to take a break to go into executive session to do our annual performance review for the director. And I expect that that'll take less than half an hour, perhaps only 15 minutes. But at that point, in the middle of our reports, the board will go to the upstairs room for its executive session, and we'll come back as soon as we can. The agenda begins with remarks from the Friends of the Library on the subject of the annex. And so, friends, who's speaking out?
Client.
Hello.
Hi.
Michael, nice to see you.
I'll be speaking in Clyde as well.
All right, and please remember to speak up because everyone wants to hear.
Sure, certainly.
Thanks.
Good evening, everybody. Thanks for coming out on this frigid night. To the board, thanks for having us tonight. We're watching Barry Miller's television program on YouTube or Vimeo or something the other day. It was another great episode, Barry. Well done. Thank you.
Thank you.
To Barry as well. I know he helps you out so much. And we remember this quote from Stuart. He said, "We are not just building an annex, we are building an institution." And we totally agree. We want to briefly address the areas of agreement we have with the FTF, the issues we have with the FTF report, and of course, why this board unanimously approved the Joel Sanders Annex Plan, and why that is still the smart, sustainable choice. Here's where we agree with the FTF. Inspire the community with great architecture. Keep the green in front of the library. Think in green with the construction. Genuine and thorough community outreach to bring, as Tim Moore said, all the pro-library forces together. Learning from the Saugerty Libraries approach. Fix what you got, as Jerry Washington eloquently stated. Here are our concerns with the FTF recommendations. Passing a bond. In 2007, we were all experiencing the economic heyday with money flowing freely right before the economic crisis that has left so many of us with decreasing salaries each year, decreasing pension funds, decreasing investment values, and the costs of goods and services increasing each year. And even then, in the prosperity of 2007, the mere possibility of a library bond vote was defeated. So now, with taxpayer dollars worth less than they were 7 years ago, it is irresponsible or unrealistic to ask taxpayers to pay for a $3 million plus bond, especially with other town projects underway with no end budget in sight. Sadly, it is the wrong time for such an expense. Waiting until there is true economic recovery is a responsible action and betters the chance of a successful bond vote. Constructing an addition without dealing with the existing library. The reality with a standalone addition proposal is that we just can't add something without truly integrating that into a renovated library. And how do we do that without being environmentally compliant? How do we do the whole thing without doubling the budget? How do we sell that to an aging town of taxpayers, many on fixed incomes and most who don't even live here full time? The real taxation without representation is taking money for a big bond from the second homeowners who don't live in Woodstock full time but will foot 60% of the bill. How do we ask for a bond for phase one, then so soon after ask for another bond for phase two? Do we actually need an additional 4,500 square feet? The FTF's barn addition adds square footage but does not create space. We shouldn't create space just to increase attendance but also to increase creativity. Any additional space should be designed around purpose and the program of the library, which the annex proposal does. Check your packet for the list of the annex uses. This is a multi-dimensional, thoughtfully planned design of what will happen in the annex. You don't have to do that now, it's in there. The FTF proposal proposes increasing administrative office space to a new total of 1,700 square feet. When you divide that number by the number of library employees, you're talking about 283 square feet per person in office space. With all due respect to our wonderful library staff, that's giving every one of them an office the size of Brett Alone's dining area. We can do better managing our space. The flex space of the annex is smart and adaptable to all the activities and people that will be in there. Hands down, it's the more economical and efficient with its space. When thinking about creating space, you must work from the inside out. Of the 18 architects who responded to your RFP, Joel Sanders spoke to the spirit of what the library is trying to accomplish. The first thing he presented as a design was nothing. It was a white box. He spoke about how people work and learn in a library space. He talked about building that space from the inside out, not what the exterior would look like. And that's why the committee chose him. It didn't hurt that he also has received multiple awards from the American Library Association for his interior and exterior designs. In the world of libraries, it doesn't get much better than that. Barn addition not actually cost effective. It's been argued that there's more, quote, bang for your buck by adding on because you're getting 4,500 square feet for less per square foot than the annex. But if you look closer at the FTF report, it doesn't quite work out that way. The proposed addition adds 4,500 new square feet, but we lose 1,700 square feet of the book barn in order to build the new addition there. So the new net square footage is actually 2,800 square feet. If you divide that into possibly $3 million, that's 1,600 square feet. Compare that to the annex budget, which at $1.5 million, which is from a professional cost estimator, not Joel Sanders' architect, the price per square foot is on the 2,050 square feet annex, which includes all the outside decks, is $741. And also remember that 1.5 is negotiable. It could be less than that. Breaking free of the piecemeal mentality. Like much of Woodstock, the library started as a small house, increasing its size after four expansions. The library grew as Woodstock did, as the quest for knowledge and community increased. It's not prudent use of taxpayer money and not wise to do another expansion. I wish we could say the time is right for the whole enchilada. As the newspaper stated last week. We actually thought of saying yes to both, of building the annex now and immediately supporting a smaller bond to renovate and reconfigure the library without any additional space. There's a strong case to be made that we don't need any more space just to have more space. But we all know, deep down, it wouldn't be worth throwing all that money at this building to renovate it. It would be throwing money down the river that sometimes flows under us. And it makes no sense to plop down a two-story addition next to the library without addressing the library's issues. The smart, sustainable, rational, reality-based plan that is achievable now is to build the annex. It gives us what we need now. No one ever claimed it gives us everything we need or could need, but it is the right plan for the right time. In the meantime, we maintain the library until 5 or 10 years down the road when the economic and political climate is ideal. We campaign for and pass a bond to replace it. Right now, after all these years, we can break free from the piecemeal mentality. Adding again, keeping one building is piecemeal. piecemeal destroys functionality. But creating a campus opens up to a whole new world. We are all standing on this precipice. We are all living in this transition zone where the digital and virtual worlds are steamrolling into our lives. There have been declarations on the death of the library. Libraries are trying to recreate their role in this new world order. Do we want our citizens, our children, to join the community or retreat into themselves, into their rooms, glued to their devices? Creating a Woodstock Library campus, a pedestrian pocket, gives the village a true midtown. It encourages more walking, direct interacting with people along the way. It creates a draw for the day trippers to walk down just a little more of our town, which in turn might just help out local shopkeepers do a little more business. We've been talking with many of them, and they want it built. There's another wave of creativity and commerce flowing through Woodstock in the last few years. We feel this revived energy. We may have lost Levon, but the keep it going mantra permeates. This is what a Woodstock Library campus does. It taps into this new energy flow. It welcomes the future while embracing our traditions. And through the hard work of many volunteers, we make sure this gift to every citizen is added to this new and improved Woodstock. Clearing up some annex objections. The scale, the location, the cost, the environmental relationship, the history, and the value of the library board's choice last year with the Joel Sanders design have still not been convincingly trumped. The merits of the annex proposal are sound and the arguments against fall flat. First, we all knew we weren't going to please everyone. To those people who don't like the exterior design because they don't see it fitting in with Woodstock's architectural style, Woodstock doesn't have an architectural style. If it does, let's call it mishmash. A quick count of the village and the surrounding area includes Colonial Farm, Colonial, Greek Revival, Primitive, Handmade House, Arts and Crafts, Mid-Century, 70s Modern, Postmodern, Contemporary, Chalet, Moorish, Federalist, Levittown. The architectural image of the annex balances new and old. Its design accommodates the library's 21st century needs, while its scale and materials are in keeping with the village surroundings. The annex's warm palette of materials takes inspiration from local landmark buildings. The painted white wood siding will match the library and neighboring town hall, and the naturally aged gray wood porches and the blue accents will recall the signature colors of Birdcliff. Parking. This always seemed like a false argument to us. I know as a financial donor who helped buy the laundromat, my wife and I were giving money to build something there, not to add a few parking spaces. The village has a parking issue, some could argue, or there just aren't enough spaces where we want them. Why wasn't this brought up with such passion when the town hall included seating for 200 in their renovation? Environmental. We're a town built on streams that's turned its back to them. In the Joel Sanders Annex, we found a functional, practical, yet elegant and innovative way to situate a building next to Tannery Brook. Joel Sanders' architect thrives on environmental challenges. This is one of many reasons he was selected. His book, Groundwork, which I highly recommend, advocates unifying culture and nature in this age of increasing environmental threat. He backs that notion up in his design. The FTF says the site is buildable. Peter Cross said the site is buildable. LNC says the site is buildable. Of course, special care will be taken raising the laundromat and constructing the annex. Then, when it is built, the annex will acknowledge and celebrate its proximity to the brook in a way that no other building in town has. The MOU. You have the legal right to this exemption. On the advice of your attorney, you exercise that right, like the Saugerties Library did. You didn't do it as a runaround to the various town boards. You didn't do it to offend anyone. You did it because it was a prudent move for you and the taxpayers. The town board listened to you in 2013 and unanimously approved the MOU. At that meeting, as the video shows, it was stated that the annex would be a larger footprint than the laundromat. There was no disagreement between the town attorney and your attorney, and there was no objection from any member of the town board. Fundraising. The Hartley Report states that the library is led by a visionary director and a dedicated, publicly elected board. and is poised to take a major, bold step in ensuring its relevance as a community library in the 21st century by building a modern, fully wired annex adjacent to the main library. Some annex critics are fond of the Hartley Report, especially the following quote. On its own, the library does not yet have the financial support, infrastructure, or internal resources to successfully conduct a $1.5 million capital campaign in the next 2 to 3 years. These critics only ever quote that first part. They always admit the very next line. A targeted public-private major gifts campaign is possible. This is possible. And when the friends hear possible, it becomes achievable. The report goes on to lay out the various crowdfunding, corporate, state, federal, and county sources for reaching $1.5 million, as well as how our two boards need to chip in. It's all laid out in there, woodstock.org. And it goes on to state that we need to raise $590,000 in private donations. I'm running on my treadmill the other day, and I'm thinking of the verbal commitment of $120,000 Claudia and I confirmed last week. $120,000 committed strictly to the JSA Annex. I do the math. It takes me a few miles, but I do the math. Based on the Hartley Report's figure of needing to raise $590,000 in private donations, we already have just over 20% in commitments. I'm still in the treadmill, and before you know it, I'm at 0.20. And I'm starting to think that's where we are with the commitments right now. And I realize this is doable. Next thing I know, I'm at 0.25. I'm at a quarter already, so I keep running. And I realize that if we all keep running, if we all roll up our sleeves and work a little harder, before you know it, we'll be at 50%. We're over the hump. It's going to be a challenge. Some weeks aren't going to be as easy as last week. And we'll be working the internet, crowdsourcing. We'll be doing friends' fundraisers. We'll be writing a hell of a lot of grants at the same time we're running for those private donations. But we'll keep doing it, and more people will join our run. And before you know it, we'll be at 75%. And trust me from running marathons, by that point, it's all a mental game. We'll keep it up through 80%, 90%, and we will cross that line. We will have put $590,000 in the bank. Politics. It's been such a crazy year. On one hand, it's been so positive, so insightful, and informative. I have a 7-year-old daughter, and she loves it. This is like a civics lesson in real time. On the other hand, it's been unnecessarily negative. 50 foils later, have we found any dirt yet on the library, or is it just a drain on the workday of our director? And you ain't seen nothing yet. When you say yes to the annex, there's going to be a lot of something hitting the fan. And let's not fall into this false equivalency game many in the mainstream media plays on the national scene. The opponents and obstructionists have said many foul things over the last year, a list too long to waste our time with tonight. But here's a couple. Accusing the friends of McCarthyism and Koch brothers tactics. Or how about implying that the library purposely hid the United States Constitution from patrons, or insinuating that the library would mislead voters on which day the library vote would occur. Or the library was purging library cards of people who opposed the annex. This kind of nonsense will not end. In fact, it'll intensify. But don't be intimidated. We got your back. Don't kick the can down the road. We got your back. We've been talking and texting with so many of our friends and neighbors since Thanksgiving, and they got your back. By far, most of the people support you, and they support the building of the annex. Over 250 postcards and growing. We've started a change.org petition that keeps adding names of local people who support you. We've gotten 2,000 views online of our video supporting the annex. 2,000. You know how many views the three videos of the last meeting when the FTF presented you with their findings? The three videos averaged less than 20 views. We got your back. And we won't stop. In fact, we really haven't started in earnest. We will keep the on the street, in the market, on our tablets discussion going until we built the annex. Because people know it's good for Woodstock, and people want this nonsense to stop. They yearn for it to stop. And it's because we've checked our egos at the door. It's always been about the merits of one project over the merits of another project for us. It's never been personal. It reminds me of what the president said last month at the State of the Union. There are a lot of good people here on both sides of the aisle. And many of you have told me this isn't what you signed up for. A better politics is one where we debate without demonizing each other, where we talk issues and values and principles and facts rather than gotcha moments or trivial gaffes or fake controversies that have nothing to do with people's daily lives. You are visionaries. You adapted to the reality of the 2007 defeat. You got us to this day by continuing to plan for our future, hosting the community via world cafes, seizing the opportunity to acquire the laundromat. The timing is right. The scale is right. You have the power, backed by a real and growing group of supporters, to break free of the piecemeal identity, to keep adding on to one building as piecemeal, creating a campus as savvy.
Can we applaud? That was fantastic. That was great.
We are here tonight to remind you that as faithful stewards of the library, we always trusted you to make the right decision on behalf of our library and the community. Because of this, the Friends honored your request to pause our pursuit of community support and funding so that the FTF you created had a voice to address the opposition. And we understood because, well, no one likes to be spanked. Build the JSA annex and pursue the community's concern of the immediate needs of the existing library. Make it energy efficient and ADA compliant. Improve the indoor air quality issues. Make more room and have flexible space while showing value and long-range thinking. Update the existing 2007 master plan you already did so methodically and thoughtfully over many years. And use Architecture Plus. You already selected them over a number of qualified architects. They already know the lay of the land. You don't need to start all over again with yet another library-savvy architect. Launching an intensive PR campaign is going to be essential. This campaign will have to explain how you brought our community together to come to your decision. It will also reflect why you should be trusted as a board, as well as communicate that the JSA Annex is a gift to the community from private donors. This is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. The JSA Annex already received two grants from New York State. If we decline these grants, then the state will be skeptical to give review time to our library in the future. This also applies to private donors. We have already received $170,000 for the JSA Annex, and we have an additional $120,000 currently pledged for the JSA Annex only. That is almost $300,000 for the JSA Annex with minimal effort. Imagine the gifts we would receive if even we had a chance to try. Can you really afford to alienate the big money donors and everyone else who donated to the JSA Annex? This campaign needs to make people understand that these gifts do not translate into gifts for the impending needs of the existing library. And quite frankly, that should be the responsibility of the community. Contrary to what some people may believe, proceeding with the JSA Annex is not moving backwards. It was just on pause. Hitting the play button, you will finally move the library forward where you left off. Anything worth achieving will always have obstacles in the way. You have to be able to have drive and determination to overcome those obstacles. The Friends do. And now, for the sake of our beloved library, you have to. I would like to close with a personal story, as I think it's very apropos for the current situation. My father lived here for the remainder of his life, but it was never a place I could call home. In addition to being legally blind, he was very sick for many years. His house reflected this, but it was all he had left, along with a mortgage. On his deathbed, he let me know that he was leaving me this house. At the time, I couldn't imagine anything worse. The house was unlivable, and I already had a mortgage of my own that I was barely making. That I was barely making on my own. I was like, thanks, but no thanks. But I was the only child and relative, so it was all my burden to bear. I wanted nothing to do with that house, but I got it. So I took a loan out to get it into livable condition, to sell, just to get myself back. This was in 2007. My husband and I were living in a 500-square-foot apartment at the time, which we had made work for us for many years, but now I was pregnant. For the sake of our family, we knew we needed to make a change. Then you'll probably remember what happened in 2008. The market tanked. When Ruby was 6 years old, I rented a car to take a look at this house that I had no chance of selling now. But I walked in, and it didn't feel the way I remembered it to feel. And it looked like someone could actually live in it. I called my husband and I said, I know we said that not only would we never live in Woodstock and most certainly never, ever in this house, but you just have to come and look. We really didn't have any other option at the time. He came to look at it. Then we looked at each other and decided to take a leap of faith and jump. And well, you can probably guess the rest. Never in a million years did I think I would end up bringing my family to Woodstock, and most certainly never ever living in the house we're now living in. But as it turns out, living in Woodstock and raising our beautiful child here has been the greatest gift for our family that keeps on giving to us on so many different levels. And now, instead of cursing my father for leaving me such a mess, we thank him every day for the gift he left us. So I ask you tonight, please do not look this gift horse in the mouth. It will be that gift that keeps on giving. Thank you. Thanks for being here.
Thank you. Is there any response from the board?
Wow.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you so much for your time and energy, your thoughtfulness, your caring. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Me too.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. The next item on the agenda is the approval of the minutes of the last two meetings, January 15th and February 5th. Amy sent those out a little while ago and put them on the website. And we're handing them out. I'd entertain, when you're, anyone's ready, a motion to approve
them. Both months are stapled together. I move they be approved.
A second. I would like to do them one at a time, and I take it Dorothea moved and Jeffrey Hanowitz seconded to move to approve the minutes of the meeting of January 15th?
Yes.
Is there any discussion of that? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, nay. The motion carries. And the same pair to move approval of the February 5th minutes?
I'll make a motion to approve this.
All right. Moved by Barry Miller, seconded by?
Jeffrey.
By Jeffrey Hanowitz. Oh, I heard him before I saw your hand. To approve the minutes of February 5th. Any further discussion? All in favor, aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, nay. The motion carries. The next item on the agenda is the financial report from Jeffrey Hanowitz, treasurer, and since Julie Parisi Kirby isn't here, Amy. And there are a couple of extra parts to this. I'll take one so that I have it in the same way. We'll start with the first page.
First page, the text and back. Can you have
one? Yeah. No, I didn't. Thank you.
So the first page is the checks and vouchers until February 13th.
D, Do we need to go have a separate motion for that and then a separate motion for the rest, approving the rest?
It would be great to have a motion that approves voucher number 14970-15004.
Okay, and then we'll have another motion to accept the treasurer's report
later.
And whatever else we need to. So take a moment, look through them.
Amy, you just mentioned one specific, something specific to look at on here.
You need to make a motion to approve the voucher numbers. So I was just telling you it was what the numbers were.
14970 at the top to 15004 at the bottom in the second column, the number column. The voucher numbers. I have to say I was surprised when I was reviewing this to see that the bill from the Mount Vernon Fire Insurance Company is for the directors and officers' liability, but I'm glad to know we have it.
Any questions about any of these?
Mm-hmm. I entertain a motion then to approve the vouchers from number 14970 to 15004.
I'll make a motion to approve vouchers 14970 through 15004.
Thank you. Moved by Caroline, seconded by Barry Miller to approve the vouchers. Any further discussion? All in favor, aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, nay. The motion carries. Thanks. Now the next page.
Next page is the balance sheet for the annex funds, which is the same from last time, as there's been no activity. The next is the other balance sheet,
which is the library's balance sheet.
Yes.
General fund.
We received our tax check, yes.
Okay.
That's true.
It's not like the good old days when it would sit and make money for you.
No. Are there any questions?
No. I make a motion to accept.
Let's go to the next one.
We'll go through the whole rest of the financial report. Thank you, Barry.
So the next is the budget versus actual so far this year.
Up through the 13th.
Yep, through the 13th. Julie comes on Fridays now, not the Tuesday before the board meeting.
I think that we're lucky to have that. Most organizations get it until the month before, so they don't get it up to the minute, or as up to the minute as this is.
Any questions? It's only February, so nothing exciting has happened really.
I'm worried about the 13 cents from the Woodstock Library tab.
13 cents?
Yeah.
Oh, they shorted us 13 cents? Right. Yep. Did not round up on that one.
Oh, that's pretty funny.
I'll make up the difference.
Couch diving.
We can make it up on one good fine if we charge fines.
Right.
But we don't.
Lucky me that you don't.
Doesn't mean we don't want them back. Any questions?
now we entertain a motion to accept the treasurer, the
financial report. I'll make a motion to accept the financial
report. Thanks, Barry. Second. So it's made by Barry Miller and second by Dorothea to approve the financial report. Any further discussion? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The motion carries. There is more, however.
There is more. So, we need to make a couple resolutions for the bank accounts. I sent this out before. I don't know if people saw it. There's three different resolutions. Right now we have a capital, what we formerly called the capital fund, which is a municipal money market account. And we're proposing to rename that fund what it actually is, which is assigned unappropriated funds. And within this fund, it'll include the library improvement fund that you authorized in January and a fund for uncompensated absences.
I'm presuming this draft banking resolutions is on the website.
It is.
Uh-huh. So, in each of the three sections, there's a little explanation of why and then a resolution. And I'd like to take the resolutions one at a time, if anyone is moved to make the first resolution.
I make a motion to approve the first resolution.
Would you read it aloud?
Therefore, aloud
so that everyone can hear.
Therefore, be it resolved to rename the capital fund account the assigned unappropriated funds account. This account will include the library improvement fund and the uncompensated absences fund.
Thank you, Caroline. Is there a second? Seconded by Barry Samuels. Any discussion of this resolution? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The motion carries. The next one is a two-part resolution having to do with opening a new bank account. Looking to my left in case anyone over here wants to move it or second it.
I will. Be it resolved to open a new account with TD Bank to be called the Capital Fund account. And be it further resolved to approve the bank resolution necessary to open the account with the same signatures as are provided in our investment policy and as established annually at the organization meeting in early January.
Thank you, Doris. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Thank you, Jeffrey. Is there a discussion of this? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Abstentions? The motion carries. And the third one, having to do with adjusting and relocating the book fund.
I'll read it.
Terrific.
Therefore, be it resolved that the municipal CD entitled Book Fund, number 4734014577, at TD Bank be closed, and the funds from that account be placed in the assigned unappropriated funds bank account, and be it further resolved that this fund retain the name Book Fund, and the funds in it shall be used for the purchase of library materials.
Thank you. Is there a second? I heard Barry Miller before you, Barry. So is there any further discussion of this? All right. All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The motion carries. Thank you.
I also want to mention that that we've received the 2013 annual review from the CPAs that I sent you all as a PDF. Mm-hmm. If anybody would like a pretty bound copy.
I would.
You're welcome to it.
Thank you.
I have many. The information for the 2004 review was with them and they're working on it now and we'll have it much sooner this year, hopefully by April.
So this is a matter of information for us from our accountants. And I have looked at it before and it doesn't have any issues, whatever the accounting term is, but they don't find that we're doing something wrong.
No. contrary to that, we're doing things right.
That's right.
That's what it says.
It says we are doing things right.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it does. Thanks. Okay, is there anything else in the financial report section? Thank you. Moving along, we come to the director's report.
So I have the new 2015 policy manual and the library board list of who's who for your notebooks. So.
I see that most everybody brought their notebook, but we don't exactly have to insert it right now.
You don't, but I said to bring it because some people like to recycle their old stuff here for whatever reason.
Oh, all right. I already recycled.
Okay.
Thank you.
Are we just passing?
Yep.
Yeah.
Oh. Mine is done, right?
Yours is done. Very.
Well, yes, unless there's an extra.
Yeah, we got one. We got it.
How are we doing? Does everybody have one?
No, Barry's already got one.
And
you will have the new pretty green.
Oh, so this
one. Mm-hmm. And you will have copies for Elaine and Kathleen.
I do, right here.
Thank you, Amy.
And the new policy manual is on the website.
All right.
As of yesterday. I mean, as of yesterday's. Okay, the other big news is that February 25th, which is a Wednesday, is Library Advocacy Day in Albany. If you can go, it's really worth going to. They need to get as many people as possible up there to kind of pack the offices of the politicians to show them how important libraries are in New York State. So I gave you some links. There's a briefing on YouTube, which was really interesting. They pick a couple different points for everybody to promote every year, so they talk about that. Also, if you can't go, they're trying to do a really strong coordinated effort to have everybody call the offices at the same time, so watch your email for information about that. There's also an online automatic letters you can send, and then you can post it on your Facebook page, and you can get all your friends to do it, and that's how we'll get the information across.
It all really works?
It definitely makes a difference. This year's is the governor's budget is proposing flat funding for libraries. The other education components of the budget are getting a 4.5% increase. So one of the things Nyla is trying to focus on is that libraries are educational institutions and should get the same increase as other educational institutions. And that's all I have to report about that. Does anybody think they're going to go? Jesse, can you go? Jesse is our special representative for that, so he always goes.
Thank you, Jesse.
Thank you. At this point, it's too late to get on the bus, so you'd have to drive yourself, which is fine. But once you get there, Mid-Hudson organizes all the appointments, and they tell you where to go when. And that's it. It's a very short report, because I was feeling like it was going to be a very long meeting, but it's now going quicker than I had anticipated. So any questions about library? Well, okay. That's all.
Thank you. The next item on the agenda is appreciations. Anybody want to appreciate anything?
I appreciate that there's so many people here tonight to keep us warm.
Thank you. I wonder if you heard that. Maybe that you need to speak up.
No, I said I appreciate that there are so many people here tonight to keep us warm.
I have an appreciation.
Uh-huh.
I just want to especially appreciate all of the board members who really worked very hard on developing the annex plan, and for all of your willingness to be responsive and step back and listen
and be open and continue to be on the board and here now, still ready to carry on in the face of certain controversy, no matter what. So I appreciate all of you for all of that work and thoughtfulness and perseverance and willingness to be flexible.
Thank you, Caroline.
You're here.
Anyone else?
I appreciate what Caroline just said.
Thank you, Barry. All right. I think we're ready to move on. Committee reports. Planning, what's new?
Well, we are going to have a meeting, but it probably won't be until March, now that Doris is back. We were waiting for you, Doris.
I'm here.
Great. But nothing else to report.
Okay, thanks. Public relations, Barry Miller.
Well, I appreciate that Michael made a comment about the TV show. The new show is up. We have one little snafu in that for some reason when we go to put it up onto the designated YouTube website, it's not ending up there. It's ending up somewhere else. So the email that I sent everybody was a link to just that video. I'm going to try to get them all onto the same channel on YouTube. For some reason, YouTube's not behaving for us. But the new show is out, and I started a new segment called Woodstock Today and Tomorrow, and I'll be interviewing Amy every month, pretty much, talking about what we're doing, and anybody else that steps forward to talk about what the library is doing and what we intend to do. So that's going to be a new segment in the show. And that's about it for now.
Thanks. Any questions? Thank you. Policy Committee. Barry Miller again.
We have a new policy. Are you going to hand that to everybody?
They're not new. We're just looking at them in a new way.
In a new way, right. There has been, and I had no idea that we had an accessibility concerns form, which people can fill out if they have a disability or a concern about disabilities. And as far as I know, nobody's ever filled the form out. So, but it is available. It's called an Accessibility Concerns Form. And what we did was we rewrote the policy on service to disabled persons and requests for accommodations and complaints about accessibility in lieu of people having opposition to Wi-Fi. As you know, the library held a symposium, and the concept of Wi-Fi and its uses were discussed. And what we've decided to do is do a compromise in writing these policies where what we're doing is we're going to turn off the Wi-Fi in one half of the building when the people who feel uncomfortable with it around them, so they can be in that part of the building.
Because just for the smart meter group meeting.
Just for the smart meter group meeting.
2 hours a month.
One of the snafus for us here is that people do come with their laptops, they sit outside, they do business work, they are using the Wi-Fi system. And if you come during the summer, I mean, people are out, cars are lined up outside, or they're sitting out on the bench with their laptops. So at this point, I don't think we're going to do away with the Wi-Fi. We're just going to turn it off as need be.
If it's requested.
If it's requested.
The group often requests that we turn off the Wi-Fi when they meet. They agreed to meet here knowing that we had Wi-Fi. A lot of people that come to their group have electromagnetic sensitivities, which may be covered under the ADA, so I wanted to just, for all of us to reacquaint ourselves that we have a policy about that, and that if people want accommodations made, that there's a process and a procedure to that. And then also that we have a wireless policy that says our Wi-Fi is on at all times 24/7.
Okay, so I don't know if any of the board members read this. Mm-hmm. They received this as an email. So I'd like to make a motion to pass this new policy. It's an update.